So maybe this will make you feel better, Charles. So there's we can actually, you know, when all else fails, change the problem. So let's say that instead of trying to learn the way we were describing it before, we're going to change the rules. We're going to say we're going to use a learning formalism that's sometimes referred to as mistake bounds. So here's how the things work in mistake bounds. The learner's sitting around and input arrives, and then the learner gets to guess an answer for that input. So the learner, maybe the learner chose the input, or maybe it came from a helpful teacher, or maybe a malicious teacher. It turns out it's not going to matter, but the input's going to show up. The learner's going to guess the answer. So it doesn't have to now guess the hypothesis and get that right. It just has to get the output correct for this input. If the learner's wrong, then we're going to charge it a point and tell it that it was wrong. And then it goes up to 1, and we repeat this. And so this is going to run forever. And what we're going to do is bound the total number of mistakes made into infinity, right? So we're going to keep playing this game forever, and we want to say it'll never make a total number of mistakes will never be larger than a certain amount. So this is giving the learner some new powers, right? So the learner now is guessing answers, and all we have to guarantee is that if it guesses wrong, it better learn a heck of a lot from that. Otherwise, even if it doesn't know much, if it guesses right, that's fine. It doesn't have to learn.
Okay, I see. So in the case before, so long as I had been guessing false, I would have been okay even if I didn't know what the hypothesis was. And then the moment I got a 1, I got a true, I could actually learn something. Then I should learn something and try to do better guesses from that point on. Okay.
Outstanding. Yes, exactly so. So let's turn that into an algorithm. So here's an algorithm that's really simple and actually can learn very effectively for these kinds of mistake-bound problems. So it works like this. It starts off in this weird state where it imagines that in the formula, every variable is present and in both its positive and negated form, right? Which is kind of weird. And so what that would mean is the formula is x1 and not x1, x2 and not x2, x3 and not x3, x4 and not x4, x5 and not x5. So any input that it gets, it's always going to produce the same answer, right? What is that answer?
False.
False, right. So it's going to keep saying false for a long time until at some point it actually could be right. Each time it's right, it's actually not getting charged any mistakes for that. It's just that at some point, it's going to get an input that the correct answer is true. It's going to say false, and it's going to have made a mistake. So let's say that here's that example. X1 is true, X3 and X4 are true, and the other two are false. And the learner said false, but the answer was actually true. So if the answer to this one is true, what do we know?
We know that 10. Wait, we know that 01001, which is the opposite of what you're saying, could not be a part of the formula. So we can remove that from our formula.
Ah, okay, that's one way to think of it. I wouldn't quite think of it that way.
But am I right?
Yeah, if this is what you meant. So the first variable, the x1 not cannot be in the formula. Because if it was, there's no way that this would have been able to produce true.
Right.
So we can erase x1 not. We can erase x2 in the positive form because of the second bit. The third bit says that x3, if it's in there, it can't be negated. We don't know if it's in there, but we know it can't be negated. X4 is the same. And x5, if it's in there.
Right, you get rid of the positive. Yeah, that's what I meant. That's why I wrote down the opposite of everything that was up there.
Yeah, and that is what we're left with. Okay, it's not exactly what the algorithm says, but it produced the right answer in this case. All right, so now what is it going to do? Now it's going to continue to say no unless it sees this particular bit pattern, right? That's the only thing that it will ever predict true on, and it'll always be right when it does that because we know that that is the correct answer for that. But so it's going to guess no everywhere else, and so let's say it gets something wrong again. Let's say it gets 10111 wrong. So in this particular case, it's going to guess no, and we say, oh, I'm sorry, the answer is yes. All right, so now what does it know from that?
Well, I'm just reading your algorithm now, and I'm just going to do what number 3 says.
All right, that's a good idea. It says, if we're wrong, which we are in this case, set all the positive variables that were 0 to absent. All the positive values that were 0, there are none of those. And set all the negative variables that were 1 to absent. All right, so then that was x5. x5 is there in its negated form, but it's actually 1 in the input. So we're going to turn that away to absent. All right?
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's the same thing that you did when we were looking at the problem before. You said if you have two answers where the two inputs where the output is both true, any bits that are different in those two patterns must be not part of the formula.
Right.
All right. So now we've X5 is not in the formula, and that's actually correct. At no point in the future will we ever have to revisit that. In these other cases, we're not quite so sure. It could be that they're in there or not in there. And so each time that we get one wrong, we're going to move something from negated to absent. And when we do that, that thing is always going to be correct. So at most, we can move k things from negated or positive to absent.
Oh, so if I think about it. Oh, so even if we may have to see, in fact, even if we may see an exponential number of examples, we will never make more than k plus one mistakes.
Perfect.
And so that's exactly what I wanted to do before, right? So if I'm a teacher, if I were a good teacher in this case, then I could basically, and I knew that you started out assuming that everything was false, that, you know, all variables were there in both their positive and negative form. I could just give you one example that is true, and that would let you eliminate half of the formula right away. And then I could just keep giving you examples that are true, but only with one variable difference each time. And then eventually you would learn it. So then the total number of samples you would need would also be k plus 1 if I know how you're starting out as a learner. Does that make sense?
If we charge things by mistakes.
No, but even if we don't charge things by mistake, if I'm a teacher who's trying to give you the best examples, and I know that as the learner you're starting out with a formula that is x1 and not x1, x2 and not x2, like you said before, then I could just give you the first example that is true. That'll allow you to eliminate half of those literals and then only give you true examples from that point on, where I only change one of the variables that are left, and you'll know that you can make them absent to get rid of it. And so just as you can only make k plus one mistakes, I could give you exactly the right k plus one examples if I know how you're starting out as a learner. If I don't know that, then I have to do the k plus two that you showed before.